What's up, my peoples? Welcome to the Afterthought. Zach Hankins here. Now, this is a response video to Karceno4life. Why the video he posted just the other day when he said that the Detroit Pistons are better than the Cleveland Cavaliers, which I just laugh. I guess he's trying to be funny. But I just think this is just my response to the video, and I'm not calling him out or anything like that. But this is just my opinion on what I think about those two teams. And this is also a response video to Heath Evans and Deion Sanders' ESPN video. For those who have watched that segment on the NFL Network, Heath Evans basically told Deion Sanders how he feels about him, about Tony Romo being released from the Cowboys. And then Deion Sanders just gave his honest truth opinion. So I'm going to get to Heath Evans in a little bit. But right now, this is all to response to Karceno's video. Okay, I watched literally like 15, 20 minutes of that video. I think Karceno was just trying to be funny. I don't think he really was serious because the man knows that the Detroit Pistons are not ready for the Cleveland Cavaliers, all right? That was just a regular season game. It's getting close near playoff time anyway. A lot of these teams, honestly, are going to be resting. They're not really looking to be going that hard right now. Cleveland has already had injuries like Kevin Love, Bogut. From what I heard, this has been injured. Broke his leg or something like that. I'm not sure what's going on, but he has an injury right now. Bogut's not healthy. J.R. Smith, I know, was hurt, and then Kevin Love has been hurt right now. They've been out, so Cleveland know they have to take it easy right now. Okay, the Cavaliers are not really looking to play that hard because they know at the end of the day, they're going to be the best seeded team anyway. The Cleveland Cavaliers are still the team you have to go through to get out the East as of currently right now. The only team I honestly see going head-to-head with Cleveland in a seven-game series is the Boston Celtics and maybe the Washington Wizards. I'm not going to put Indiana in there because I don't know if Indiana even has a team no more. Paul George is just not into it no more. He's trying to leave Indiana. Okay, yeah, Indiana is going to be a playoff team, but they're not that effective, all right? They're not challenging Cleveland. And I will say Toronto, but with Kyle Lowry now out for the season with his injury, as of currently right now, they need Kyle Lowry big time, okay? Kyle Lowry is like makes up maybe half of Toronto's offense besides DeRozan, because DeRozan can't even shoot threes right now. Kyle Lowry is roughly their best three-point shooter. And now they got a Serge Ibaka, but even then, Ibaka's not going to be enough right now. They need Kyle Lowry at the point guard position. Well, Lowry is going to be bad. Yeah, you got Nolan Powell, but even then, he's not a point guard. They don't really have a good backup point guard like that. So that's the problem with Toronto. That's why I don't have Toronto really being that effective right now. That team doesn't go to a championship without Kyle Lowry. Kyle Lowry and DeRozan, that's the main two that you need to get you to the finals. They don't have that yet, so they're going to have to try again next year. And it's sad because Toronto has so much potential right now. They have so much promise. This team did get to the Eastern Conference Finals last year. Okay, so Toronto's already out the picture. But yeah, the way the Washington Wizards have been playing as of recently right now, the way John Wall has matured and maintained himself with Bradley Beal, that's already a dangerous backcourt. Okay, like them getting Scott Brooks was the best thing for the Wizards right now as far as the moves they've made the past 3 or 4 years. Okay, so the Wizards are actually on the right track right now. They're at the right step. And matter of fact, if I was Kevin Durant, I would have went to the Washington Wizards. And I understand the whole family thing, but at the end of the day, if you would have went to the Wizards, that would put Wizards in the championship. They'll be on their way to the finals. Okay, I understand people are getting tired of seeing LeBron James. But see, this is what Karceno must understand right now. LeBron James is not the problem with the NBA right now, okay? He needs to stop blaming them so much. Yeah, okay, I understand he doesn't like LeBron James on the court, but this is the problem right now. You know what I'm saying? Teams, the Eastern Conference has been weak for a very long time, okay? Which is going to get my point back to the Detroit Pistons right now. The Wizards are actually making the right steps, okay? Them hiring Scott Brooks was the right step because Scott Brooks has got to the finals before. He's played against LeBron James. You give Scott Brooks the right team, he could possibly beat LeBron James out, all right? Now, the Detroit Pistons, okay? The Pistons don't have a bad team at all. So, this is just to Karceno right now. And I hope Karceno somehow sees this video because this is my whole take on it. All right? The Pistons have a potential team right now. They're getting better, but they're still not there yet. Okay? The Pistons are still working on a legit core right now, okay? And you look at the roster, which I'm taking notes, okay? You have Reggie Jackson, all right? Reggie Jackson has been a man on the bench that entire time. Like, this is like the second season where he's got a starter. They obviously paid him the contract money. He's a decent point guard. He's just not a great point guard. Reggie Jackson's not going to give you 25, 27-something points. He's not going to give you no triple-doubles like a James Harden or a Russell Westbrook. All right? yeah, he's a decent point guard here and there, but even Karceno, you questioned Reggie Jackson's ability on the court. You said that Ish Smith was a better than Reggie Jackson, that Reggie Jackson should be benched, which is a roughly argument because Ish Smith has skills too, but Ish Smith's problem, like, he could be a little undersized. All right, yeah, Ishmael is agile. He has ability, but Reggie Jackson, like I said, he just has experience. Reggie Jackson has played amongst Durant, Westbrook, Harden, so, like I said, he's came from the Western Conference, so he knows what it's like to be in the finals, so that's the only way Reggie Jackson has the advantage over Ish Smith. Then you have Andre Drummond. Now, Andre Drummond's probably their legit center. He's been in the league a while, but the problem with Andre Drummond, that compared to Al Horford, compared to Dwight Howard, you know, compared to a DeAndre Jordan, he's really unperformed. Even Greg Monroe from Milwaukee plays much better than Andre Drummond. Yeah, Andre Drummond's a big man. He's a good rebounder, but the problem with Andre Drummond, he's not even taking over games himself. Okay, he's not a go-to guy. That's been a problem with Andre Drummond. There's other big men that's been outperforming him for years now. And yeah, he's been there, like I said, he's been there quite a while, but for Andre Drummond, I don't know what it is, but like I said, he's a decent, I don't want to say necessarily quality. He's a good center. He's just not a great center. He's not a Shaquille O'Neal type center. Okay, he's not Hakeem Olajuwon. All right. And furthermore, compared to Cleveland right now, Andre Drummond is nothing compared to Tristan Thompson. Yeah, Andre Drummond got some skill there, but even then, he doesn't have the size Tristan Thompson has. Tristan Thompson, I think, is technically taller than Andre Drummond and bigger than him. Okay, that's the one advantage Cleveland has over Detroit right now is the center position right now. Andre Drummond is more of a power forward. He's naturally a power forward. He's not even a center like that. He could play center, but even then, he's not. I wouldn't necessarily make him out to be a center all that much because, like I said, he's not taking over games like he should be. Now, Stanley Johnson is young right now, okay? He's like, I think it's like his first or second year in the league. I think his second or third year. I think he was a rookie last year. He was a rookie last year. This is Stanley Johnson. So, the only time will tell how good Stanley Johnson materialized, how good he plays, but he's not a bad small forward. He just, like I said, he needs time to materialize. He needs time to mature. He needs time to really develop. Okay, so it's not that Stanley Johnson wasn't a bad pick, but he's just not his time yet. Now, Caldwell Pope's another guard, like Reggie Jackson's been in this league a while. The problem with Caldwell Pope is that he's too quiet, okay? There's other guards in this league, especially the Eastern Conference, who plays much better than him. They average more points than he is. He does a little bit more. Caldwell Pope is not doing anything amazing. He's not doing too much that people will remember for. This is the reason why analysts and commentators don't mention Caldwell Pope all that much. Caldwell Pope doesn't really make too many highlights. Okay, he doesn't really make too many appearances with ESPN than the other guards in the league. You got Bradley Beal over there. You got a J.R. Smith. Okay, Kyrie Irving. You got all these other guards. He doesn't really do too much. I mean, like I said, he'll give you 15 to maybe 18 points a game. He'll have his little two or three steals, but like I said, he's not doing enough for that team that says he's a franchise player. Okay, now you have Tobias Harris. Now, Tobias Harris actually makes sense. Okay, he's a decent player, all right, since leaving Orlando. That's somebody Orlando should have actually kept. If I was the manager, I would have kept Tobias Harris, okay? You gave up Oladipo. You traded him to Oklahoma City, but Tobias Harris was a leader. I would have kept Tobias Harris on that team along with Aaron Gordon. Those two worked out well with each other. I would have never gave up Tobias Harris. Now, Tobias Harris is a player you can actually build your team around. Matter of fact, him and even Marcus Morris. Marcus Morris is part of the Morris Twins. Him and his brother Markeith. Marcus Morris and Tobias Harris are the only two players decent that's in that Detroit Pistons lineup that's actually quality. Because even Marcus Morris has been around this league for quite a while now. He's something like a veteran. He knows how to win games. But them the only two I'll build my team around. Reggie Jackson, like, yeah, he's okay. He's all right. He's just not exciting. And like I said, Caldwell Pope is just too quiet. Caldwell Pope is not taking over games. He's not putting the game in his hands. Caldwell Pope is not a player that you can actually put the ball in his hands and let him take over the game. He's not going to finish it for you. And that's been a problem, too, with Detroit over the past, like, 8-9 years. They haven't had a full closer yet. Matter of fact, Detroit hasn't had a finisher since the days of Rip Hamilton, Tayshaun Prince, the Wallace players, the Wallaces, and then you had Chauncey Billups. Okay, even Chauncey Billups was a finisher for Detroit. They have not been the same since. Okay, so that's what Karceno understand. The Detroit Pistons not beating the Cleveland Cavaliers in a 7-game series. Yeah, Detroit Pistons could have a win or two in the regular season, but playoff time come when April comes around. You in April, May, and June, and it really matters. The Cavaliers come to play. Okay, see, that's what's so great about LeBron James. He makes everybody around him better. He elevates the teams. Okay, there's not a player in this league who wouldn't want to play for LeBron James if they can. This is why they're able to get a. This is why they're able to get the players they got and able to get a Darren Williams, okay? This is why they're able to get a Kyle Korver, Andrew Bogut, all right? And even Andrew Bogut. Andrew Bogut, see, the Cavaliers is an opportunity for him to get his revenge on Golden State right now. This is another reason why the Cleveland Cavaliers didn't mind taking a chance with Bogut, because they know how much they did Bogut wrong. Andrew Bogut, along with Harrison Barnes, Festus Ezeli, Maurice Bates, Leandro Barbosa, they was all against the Warriors getting Kevin Durant in the first place. They figure we beat Durant after we came back from being down 3-1 against Kevin Durant. We mentally broke him down. We physically beaten him off the line. We kept him from going inside the paint. We forced him to take bad shots. Why does a 73-9 team that beat the Chicago Bulls record that was set and led by Michael Jordan, along with all those other guys, with Scottie Pippen, okay, that had that, with Charles Oakley, that had that amazing team. Why, you know what I'm saying, you had Steve Kerr on that team. You had Vinny, you had Kukoc, okay, and Dennis Rodman. Why does a team like the Warriors beat that amazing Bulls team that was good as they was in the 90s? Why do you need to get a Kevin Durant? And see, they knew those guys have to leave anyway, which really wasn't fair, okay? Andrew Bogut helped win that team a championship. Andrew Bogut was part of the core that made Golden State what it is today. Golden State would have never won a championship had it not been for Andrew Bogut's appearance last year. Or 2 years ago, okay? The main reason why that team went 73-9 is because players like Bogut that contribute to that team. And defensively, Andrew Bogut was right for the Golden State Warriors. For them to let Bogut go and release him just to make a sacrifice for Kevin Durant just shows that the Warriors just being greedy. And it just shows that Kevin Durant wanted it easy. But this is not about them right now. This is about the Cleveland Cavaliers. Okay, so Karceno, you got to get mad at the Detroit Pistons organization for not getting the right picks, okay? You got to get mad at them for not finding the next type of LeBron James, all right? Someone that can replace LeBron, who can be better than LeBron. Get mad at them, all right? Like I told you, after that 04-05, yeah, Detroit Pistons led the East. And you're going to understand this too, Karceno. You must have forgot about LeBron James' early years, since 2003. I remember LeBron James in his first 5 years in the league, he wasn't winning championships like that. The Detroit Pistons was dominating the East. Then them, the New Jersey Nets, and the Boston Celtics were the main three teams in the East in between 2002 and like 2010. Those three particular teams, and yeah, Detroit was 04-05, and even then, they were still a contending team. The New Jersey Nets, in between 2002, like 2001 through like 2004 or 2005, when you had Jason Kidd, you had Richard Jefferson on that team, you had Terry Kittles, you had Jason Collins, all right? They had a legit squad. Even Vince Carter came over there. They was running the East. That was a team that was literally had a force to be reckoned with. The Nets was nowhere in the condition they are now. Back then, when they was in New Jersey, they was a good. That was a good team. I'm telling you that now. And then you had the Boston Celtics. Once Garnett and Pierce got acquired over there from by Doc Rivers in free agency, they made them a legit contender. Okay, LeBron James had problems beating these teams out. I remember the Cavaliers was losing in like the second round, losing Eastern Conference. Yeah, 2007, they got that in there. They got in. Okay, LeBron James helped carry that team. Him and Zydrunas Ilgauskas was good together. But they was never going to beat the San Antonio Spurs, okay? It took LeBron James to have the experience to become a better player to help the Cavaliers be who they are today, all right? LeBron James went to Miami because Cleveland, he wasn't giving no help in Cleveland. And I said there was other situations is the reason why LeBron James didn't stay in Cleveland. Situations with his mom going with another basketball player that ruined the locker room right there. So LeBron James went to protect his mom scandal. That's the other reason why he went to Miami. And furthermore, he wanted to get more experience. He wanted to play with Dwayne Wade and Bosch, who he's real close with. Those were his friends, along with Chris Paul. Chris Paul was, you know what I'm saying, basically sliding off with the Clippers, but still, Bosch, Wade, and LeBron are close anyway. They hang out with each other after the season, when it's offseason, in the summertime. Okay? So he went to Miami because he wanted to play under Pat Riley. He wanted that experience to play with Eric Spoelstra, players who won a championship with Miami before. So LeBron James went over there all that time. He even said, I'm going to come back to Cleveland and win them a title. So LeBron James kept his promise last year. Okay? So Karceno, get mad at Detroit for not finding a good player. Get mad at Detroit for not drafting a Kyrie Irving type player, a Kawhi Leonard, a James Harden, an Isaiah Thomas. Get mad at them for doing that. Okay? And I'm not, they got an Isaiah Thomas. I'm talking about the shorter Isaiah Thomas. Even him is balling. Why? How could they couldn't find a player like that? Okay? Get mad at them for not finding out, not trying to bring Al Horford over there. Y'all had Josh Smith and Brandon Jennings. You see where that worked out. That went nowhere. And Brandon Jennings was actually a good guard. Detroit basically brought down Brandon Jennings' value over there. And I mean, it's sad too, because Brandon Jennings, when he was in Milwaukee, Brandon Jennings was putting up good numbers, all right? He was a quality guard. He was like a top 10 point guard over there. Okay, Brandon Jennings was helping Milwaukee beat that team, but it just wasn't working out. He comes to Detroit, and you see what happened. He just, like I said, his whole value gets brought down. Josh Smith the same way. Josh Smith should never went to Detroit. If that's the case, Josh Smith should just stayed with the Atlanta Hawks, okay? He should have stayed over there with Kyle Korver. Like I said, they had Paul Millsap, they had Al Horford. He should have stayed with that team in 2015. If Josh Smith was still on the team in 2015, like I said, the Hawks might have would have beaten Cleveland. I'm telling you that now. The Hawks won 60 games without Josh Smith. Imagine if they would have still had Josh Smith. Now I understand Josh Smith was kind of a selfish player. He liked to take a whole lot of threes. He didn't like to pass the ball. So he's become a problem for the locker room. But still, Josh Smith just wasn't the same when he went to Detroit. So even him going to Detroit messed him up big time. Once again, messed up his whole value. Okay? And that was before Stan Van Gundy came over there. Okay? Look at the coaches y'all had. Okay, after the Sixers got. He was in Detroit that time. He won them a championship, and then he left. After he left, y'all ain't been the same since. Okay, y'all let Chauncey Billups go to Denver. Yeah, he left Detroit and went to Denver. Y'all tried to get Allen Iverson over there. That didn't work out because Allen Iverson wanted to start, and Rip Hamilton wasn't having it. Rip Hamilton said, man, I won this team a championship. Okay, I've been over this whole time. Allen Iverson, who was you? You can't just come over here and take one of my team. And then you see where AI went. AI went nowhere after that. Okay, so Karceno, stop blaming LeBron James for y'all problems right now. Y'all got a good team, but see, Karceno, why don't you do like Jerry West is doing, and why don't you become a advisor for it? Karceno, I can actually see you being an advisor and telling them who to draft. Karceno, I think you need to take a position with the Detroit Pistons and help them out. They could use your help. You know, Karceno, why don't you try to get a GM position over there? Because Karceno, I believe you could change the Detroit Pistons. I really truly believe you could turn them around. Karceno, with your basketball knowledge, I believe that can help Pistons a whole lot. You say Isaiah Thomas is the greatest player. He's better than Michael Jordan. Well, Karceno, why don't you find that next point guard? You don't like Reggie Jackson. Why don't you go, you know what I'm saying, talk to them, advise with them, consult with them, and find another point guard out there. There's plenty of other guards out there. But that's just how the Detroit Pistons run. And they're just not there. They're not there yet, basically. Maybe they'll be ready. I give them maybe 2 or 3 years. And it all depends on what they do now. It all depends on what Stan Van Gundy is going to do. Because, yeah, Stan Van Gundy got the Orlando Magic's to the finals, but that's because he had an actually veteran team. He had Rashard Lewis, he had Hideo Turkoglu, Jameer Nelson, Michael Petras. Okay, and even Courtney Lee was actually one of the best draft picks in that class. Okay, he helped them got to the finals. And now it's his first year in. Actually started in the first he started in the finals. Okay, he got in the rotation. Then you had Skip to Malou, Rayford, or Austin. Okay. Orlando had a stacked up team. That was Dwight Howard at his best. Okay, notice how the Magic ain't been the same since after Dwight Howard left. Okay, but this is the problem with the Detroit Pistons. They just don't have a team yet. And even if they play the Boston Celtics in the second round, be a 7 seed, they're still not going to make it. The Boston Celtics would actually beat them. Okay, now the Boston Celtics will actually last maybe five or six games. But Cleveland is basically going to sweep Detroit. They play them in the first round. So, Karceno, don't be surprised at that. You say Detroit is better than Cleveland now. Wait till playoff times come. And we're going to see how good the Detroit Pistons really is. All right? Now, on to Heath Evans, okay? He asked Deion Sanders how he feels about Tony Romo leaving the Cowboys. So, like I said, Deion Sanders was honest. He said Tony Romo really doesn't need to retire. And it makes sense, okay? Tony Romo has been in this league over 10 years, all right? He only has 2 playoff wins, but he has more money. Tony Romo was one, actually, if y'all think about it, Tony Romo was actually one of the highest paid quarterbacks in the league behind a Tom Brady, all right? Him and Jay Cutler had high paid contracts. Tony Romo had between 14 and 15 million alone the last 2 years. So you understand why Jerry Jones has to get Tony Romo out of there. He's costing the team a lot of money. And furthermore, the money we pay Tony Romo, we need to use to sign our players. Like Trent Williams had to get re-signed. David Irvin had to re-sign, okay? You have to re-sign Bryce Butler. No sense. You could keep your receiver guard solid. We need that money. And salary cap Tony Romo was taking from us so we could get players in free agency right now. And if we can make moves in the draft that we want and need. Okay? Let Prescott have that team. Tony Romo stepped aside, all right? But the fact that Heath Evans said that, you know what I'm saying, going to come at Deion Sanders, that was really kind of foul, okay? Because, like I said, Deion Sanders knows what he's talking about. Okay, yeah. Tony Romo doesn't even retire. And I understand Heath Evans, no saying, you a veteran, you want to get a ring. But think about it. Tony Romo is fragile right now, okay? One hit from Tony Romo and he's gone. He's done. And you got to think about it, too. Denver needs a quarterback that's going to remain healthy, all right? Peyton Manning's last year, he was not fully healthy at all. I'm going to just be honest. Peyton Manning was literally, it was time for him to go anyway. But he wanted to get his ring, and so he got that. But still, Peyton Manning was not, Peyton Manning alone missed 8-9 games. Would have missed 10 had he not benched him. They didn't have benched Osweiler that last play of the game, which was really messed up. Okay, John Arias allowed Kubiak to screw up that whole situation. Because to me, Osweiler could have won them a Super Bowl. Okay, they could have won with Peyton Manning on the bench. Osweiler was that good. He was behind Peyton Manning 2 years prior to that. John Elway did not need to waste money on Mark Sanchez. You know what I'm saying? Trade, not even re-sign Osweiler. He could have re-signed Osweiler. All right, so I can understand how Emmanuel Sanders don't want Tony Romo, but if you Denver, you got this good defense, do you really want somebody like Tony Romo that can't even get past the second round? Okay, ask yourself that. Even Houston right now, Houston needs a quarterback that's going to be reign healthy. They need a quarterback that's going to be there for the long run. They don't need a quarterback that's only going to be here for 1 year, all right? Even Houston right now, they just traded Osweiler and wasted all that money. Like I said, bad general management position. Which I told you what happened with Detroit right now. You got these owners and GMs that don't know how to manage their teams. They know how to spend their money. The Houston Texans have wasted too much money. They wasted over $30 million, all right? Just alone. Even trading Osweiler there. You only keep him one season. Even though Osweiler almost lost Houston a chance to go to the playoffs. That's what I understand why Heath Evans is trying to put the Texans over the Cowboys right now because Romo's gone. All right? If y'all remember correctly, Jacksonville was almost this close to beating Houston. Houston had to bench Osweiler. They had to put in the second-string quarterback for the whole second half. And the second-string quarterback made the right decisions to put them in the game. And then because of Jadeveon Clowney coming back and because Houston had good DBs, they picked off Jacksonville and won that game. Just barely, by a field goal, okay? Osweiler was benched the last two games, and then they put him in against the Raiders team. Of course, he was going to beat the Raiders. The Raiders had injuries, okay? So this is the problem with the Houston Texans. Yeah, they can easily get Tony Romo right now, but how long are they going to keep Tony Romo, all right? This is the problem right now with the Cowboys, which to me, I would just release Tony Romo and get rid of, but I guess Jerry Jones wants something to trade for him right now. Tony Romo sees that a lot of his players are getting picked up by other teams right now. You see these teams like Tampa Bay making moves, signing DeSean Jackson. He sees Philadelphia getting Torrey Smith over there and Alshon Jeffrey. Okay, you see the New York Giants signing Brandon Marshall. Jerry Jones wants something for Tony Romo. He said, okay, if Denver and Houston wants Tony Romo this badly, trade me, give me a player. Give me at least a draft pick or give me a defensive player that I need and I can use, and I'll let you have Tony Romo. So that's all Jerry Jones is doing right now. The man, believe it or not, is very smart. Jerry Jones has put together good rosters. Just the simple fact we had a quarterback that just couldn't get the job done. All right? So I don't agree with Heath Evans at all. Once again, it's just a lot of hatred for the Cowboys. Heath Evans is mad that his favorite team didn't get Dak Prescott, what this really comes down to. Heath Evans is mad that the Saints didn't get an Ezekiel Elliott. So he doesn't want to see the Cowboys win a championship. And see, Heath Evans knows this too. Evans knows that if the Cowboys win a Super Bowl, if they get to a Super Bowl and win a championship, win a world title, it changes the whole dynamic of the NFL. Everything is flipped around if the Cowboys do good. And see, Heath Evans is mad at the fact that Cowboys even went 13-3 in the first place with a rookie quarterback. He's upset the fact that Tony Romo's not there no more. And this is actually what it's coming down to. It's coming down to a lot of players in the league who had respect for Tony Romo, who were friends with Tony Romo, such as Heath Evans. And are mad that Romo is really released from the Cowboys. He is mad that Tony Romo is really being traded right now. He's not going to stay a Dallas Cowboy. He is mad at the fact that Tony Romo is not there to choke up the team for the Cowboys so the Cowboys can stay down. That's what Heath Evans is really mad at. Heath Evans don't want the Cowboys to shine at all. All right? Y'all got to understand that the Cowboys played against a lot of players like Heath Evans who are rivals with the Cowboys in there who they played against. You know what I'm saying? Heath Evans was there when New Orleans was beating the crap out the Cowboys all that many times. So to see the Cowboys get a player like Dak Prescott, Ezekiel Elliott, have a player like Trent Williams, have all these good defensive players, Heath Evans cannot stand that at all. He hates that, okay? Because how in the hell are you going to put a Houston Texans team that didn't even have half the record, didn't have the closer, they didn't go 13-3. The Houston Texans didn't win 12 games in a row. How are you going to put that over the Cowboys, okay? Dak Prescott's rookie year, he played better than Jared Goff, Carson Wentz, and Paxton Lynch. And you're going to say that the Houston Texans are getting to the championship before the Cowboys? Hell no. All right? Yeah, the Houston Texans, they're actually there. They're set The Houston Texans need a quarterback right now, and they need more offensive guys. They're still not there yet, all right? They got the defense. Don't get me wrong. Houston defensively is there. Offensively, it's just not there. I give Houston two more years, all right? But Houston got to make the right picks, first of all. So, for on Houston, Heath Evans need to park his brakes with that, all right? He's saying a little bit too much right now. So, that's just my response to Heath Evans. I hope Heath Evans look at this video right now because that's my two cents on it. Heath Evans do not need to be putting Houston Texans above the Cowboys. The Cowboys are going to get to the Super Bowl before the Houston Texans do. And you can mark my words on that. Okay, look at Gary Kubiak. Gary Kubiak did nothing for that team at all. He only went to Denver because he inherited a good team from John Fox. John Fox can't get the Super Bowl, so John Emery hired Gary Kubiak. Gary Kubiak's situation is the same, exact same as Mark Jackson's from the Golden State Warriors, all right? Gary Kubiak and Steve Kerr inherited great teams that already set for a championship, all right? And you see where Gary Kubiak is. He's fired right now. He's not even in Denver. John Emery released him just after the season. They didn't make the playoffs. No sense. So Gary Kubiak is once again Gary Kubiak again. All right? Gary Kubiak didn't go out there and try to find a decent quarterback. I don't know why he went after Mark Sanchez. That was stupid as hell. If I'm Gary Kubiak, I would have told John Elway no. Why sign Mark Sanchez? You could have went somewhere else in another direction. Like I said, they could have drafted a Doc Prescott. Why didn't you go after Doc Prescott, Gary Kubiak? Why? I do not know, but then again, like I said, a lot of this comes down to on and like I said, I don't like bringing up the skin color word, but it is what it is. All right? I don't know what Denver's true intention was, but they could have drafted Dak Prescott there. Imagine Dak Prescott with that Denver Bronco team now would have put Denver back in a Super Bowl. Okay? Like, even just in case, even if, let's say last season, the Denver Broncos could have made a legit playoff run with Dak Prescott in that Denver Broncos uniform. But they passed up on him like many other teams. I was grading it now. So this is the afterthought. Like I said, this is just my response to Karceno. Like I said, Karceno, I respect for you, my brother. I enjoy watching your videos, but I just think you putting Detroit above Cleveland off of what was it, maybe one regular season win is not right. Karceno, you can say that Detroit is better than Cleveland when they actually beat the Cleveland Cavaliers in a playoff series. Let Detroit take Cleveland to its limit in a game 7. Let them actually survive and beat Cleveland at their house, okay? Then you can say the Detroit Pistons are better than Cleveland Cavaliers, all right? Karceno, the days of Detroit being better than Cleveland is not there anymore, all right? That's when you had the Wallaces. That's when you had Tayshaun Prince, Rip Hamilton, Chauncey Billups. Y'all don't have that no more, Karceno. Y'all need to develop your core first. And to Heath Evans, shame on you right now. Matter of fact, I want to see the look on Heath Evans' face when the Cowboys actually get to the Super Bowl possibly next year. When Dak Prescott has a year, Russell Wilson did his sophomore year. And Jerry Jones makes the right picks, he signs the right free agencies, and the Cowboys wind up going to the Super Bowl and Dak Prescott wins. I want to see what Heath Evans has to say then. I want to see what Heath Evans have to say if the Cowboys go higher and they win 15, 16 games next season. I want to see the look on Heath Evans' face when he finds out the Cowboys get out the NFC Championship. That's what I want to see. Matter of fact, I want to see the look on Heath Evans' face when we don't get swept by the Giants no more. And Dak Prescott beats teams he didn't beat last year. Okay? Because the only team Dak Prescott has to prove he can beat is the Giants. All right? He done went through the Pittsburgh Steelers, the Baltimore Ravens. He played some of the toughest teams. He even beat the Green Bay Packers in the regular season, which has not happened in a long time for the Cowboys. Okay? See, that's what Heath Evans is mad at. The Cowboys underachieved. They proved Colin Cowherd wrong. See, now you see Colin then changed his mind. He didn't knock some sense to his head. Heath Evans, yeah. Shouts out to you. I want to see what you got to say if the Cowboys do get to the Super Bowl next year. What you going to say then? Are you going to still put the Houston Texans above them next year? That's the question. This is Afterthought. Shouts out to my subscribers. Shouts out to the ones who liked that video. Shouts out to my loyal listeners. Y'all stay blessed. Stay tuned. I'll see you soon.